We can now look at energy-driven feedbacks. And we start by looking at the ionizing radiation. So massive stars produce ionizing radiation, and ionizing here means energies h nu larger than 13.6 electron volts, because this is the ionization energy of atomic hydrogen. So since the majority of the gas is hydrogen gas, when we are looking at ionizing radiation, this is what we mean. And when we look at a cluster, then we find that the number of photons that these cluster produce that have sufficient energy to ionize a hydrogen atom, we find something like 6.3 times 10 to the 46 photons per second and solar mass. When we average this over the total lifetime, we find a huge number, 4 times 10 to the 60 photons per solar mass. Every single photon can ionize one hydrogen atom, and therefore these clusters can produce a large volume of ionized gas. We will now look at the properties of these bubble of ionized gas. So the physical process is such that this radiation is quickly absorbed by the atomic gas and is ionized. And it produces this bubble of ionized gas, which also contains the same number of electrons. So we will have also many collisions between electron and protons that might lead to a recombination. If we have some photons left, they will be re-ionized, and this depends on the number of atoms and the number on the number of ions and electrons in my volume. So for a certain number of ionizing photons, we can keep up a certain constantly ionized volume of hydrogen gas. So an equilibrium is formed, an equilibrium between ionization and recombination, and the size of these so-called Strömgren 4 is the Strömgren radius RS. And it's computed from equating the number of ionizing photons with the number of recombination processes, which is just the product of the number densities of the collision partners, electrons and protons, times basically the rate at which they then recombine, so to speak a probability, times the volume of my sphere. And when we put in typical numbers, we can then compute the Strömgren radius. So reforming this equation gives us here this expression for the Strömgren radius, and we can write it down somewhat differently in units of parsec times the number of ionizing photons, here with the power of 1/3, and the density N2. And these numbers are here given as 49 means S in units of 10 to the 49 per second, and N2 means my density in units of 10 to the 2. So for typical conditions, Strömgren radii are in the order of 2 to 3 parsec. The material in the ionized gas will be very hot. It will be heated up to 10,000 Kelvin. At these temperatures, we find sound speeds in the order of 11 kilometers per second. That weakly depends on the temperature. And from this sound speed, we can also compute the pressure inside, which is just the density times the sound speed squared. And this is a much higher pressure compared to the ambient pressure, because the temperatures on the outside are a few orders of magnitude lower. Therefore, the pressure in the Strömgren sphere is much higher than the pressure in the ISM. We should also mention here, because this was given as H2, the Roman 2 with the H here means singly ionized. This is an historical spectroscopic notation. One means neutral, and three, for example, would mean doubly ionized, and so on. So we are also talking of H2 regions when we talk about these Strömgren spheres. Now, we saw that the pressure in this sphere is significantly higher than the ambient pressure, which automatically means that these regions will start to expand. And since our ionization timescale is much, much shorter than the expansion, the dynamical expansion timescale, we can assume that during the expansion, this ionization balance is kept while the bubble expands. When we now look for a given radius, Ri, after the expansion started, the density inside the H2 region will now be modified because the material expanded for a certain time. And due to this expansion, we will have a sweep up of the surrounding material at the surface of my hot ionized bubble. So mass accumulates in a neutral shell around my H2 region. And we will now look at later times when the size of my ionized gas is much larger than the initial Strömgren radius, and therefore the density in my shell is very, very much lower than the initial density, which means for the moment we can then neglect the mass in the shell interior, because the swept up mass in the shell equates basically the volume of this shell times the initial density, which is a much, much higher number. So kinematically, we are only interested in the equation of motion for the shell material, which we can write down like this, assuming here this behavior for the density. And we neglect the ambient pressure at this. So to solve this generally, we need a numerical solution. But when we look at late times, for large radii Ri, we can look at analytical solutions. And we will look at the similarity solution of this differential equation by using a trial solution for the radius of this form as a function of this power law index eta. And Ts can be given here in units of the ionization flux and density and temperature, because Ts is just the ratio of the Strömgren radius and the sound speed. And when we do this, insert everything, we find the following equation, and this only has a solution in case of 4 eta minus 2 equals eta half. Therefore, eta needs to be 4/7, and f consequently needs to be this factor then. So we can write down the expression for our ionized radius, and given here in these quantities, we find that this is 9.4 parsec times our flux, density, temperature, and times. And here T6 is the time given in 10 to the 6 years. So comparing this with the initial 2.8 parsec, we saw that the radius is about 3 times larger after 1 mega year. So when we look now at the feedback effect of these regions, we saw that it sweeps up material, so it accelerates the surrounding gas. It injects momentum into this gas. And the effect on the giant molecular cloud is that it can eject mass and drive turbulent motion and maybe even disrupt the cloud. And the process for the mass ejection is, we saw that we have a star here that forms the ionized bubble of gas that is expanding and thinner than the surrounding giant molecular cloud. If this happens close to the surface, this expanding shell might break free through the surface of our cloud, and we have a much thinner material here on the outside, so which leads then to an unhindered expansion of this hot bubble of gas, a so-called blister outflow that carries away a lot of material and can even disrupt the cloud if we imagine that this happens at many locations in the cloud simultaneously. The maximum mass flux that is carried by the ionized wind is just here the surface of the shell, of this ionized shell, and multiplied with the density in the ionized shell and the sound speed. Now we saw expressions for Ri and the density E, so we can express this mass flux in terms of our ionization quantities, so the flux, the density, temperature and time, and we find that the mass flux is in the order of 7.2 times 10 to the minus 3 solar masses per year. So this is here not per solar mass, but solar mass per year. Panding H2 region can eject up to 10 to the 3, 10 to the 4 solar masses of mass from its parent cloud. Given that the density is not too large, because for the density we have here an inverse dependence. So massive stars can eject many times their own mass from a giant molecular cloud. And when we look at the energy that is contained in the expanding shell, so we saw we can compute the velocity of the expanding shell, we find that these are maybe up to 10 to the 48 erg. This is small compared to the binding energy of a giant molecular cloud with 10 to the 5 solar masses. So a single O star, even though it can carry away maybe a few 10,000 or maybe a few thousand solar masses, this will have comparably little effect on the giant molecular cloud, but when we have a cluster of 100 O stars, they might produce sufficient energy to overcome the total binding energy of the giant molecular cloud and disrupt it entirely. The momentum of this expanding shell is about 10 to the 5 solar masses kilometer per second. And given the non-linearity in the ionizing flux and the time, this of course then depends on how the stars are clustered and how long they live to compute the momentum effect on the GMC. So typical numbers for ionization photon fluxes are in the order of 10 to the 49, H of 4 mega years, and N and T in our special units of 1, this produces a momentum of 3 to 5 times 10 to the 5 solar masses, kilometer per second. When we look at 0H population, that gives 6.3 times 10 to the 46 photons per second and per solar mass. Then the momentum injection rate for H2 regions is a few thousand kilometers per second. Comparing this to the numbers of a few 10 or maybe 1 or 200 kilometers per second from the previous cases, we see that H2 regions are most likely the dominant feedback effect in the giant molecular cloud. So one limitation is that when we look at the velocities of the ionized shell of the order of 10 kilometers per second, then we have the problem that a massive star cluster might have escape velocities that are comparable. So the mass of the massive cluster might limit the velocity of the expanding shell and therefore prevent the disruption of the giant molecular cloud. We can also look at stellar winds. O stars have winds with velocities in the order of 1,000 up to maybe 2,500 kilometers per second and a mass flux in the order of 10 to the minus 7 solar masses per year. So this is a relatively small momentum when we compare it to other effects. However, the high velocities produce extremely high post-shock temperatures. We saw velocities of 10 Kelvin earlier, 10 kilometers per second earlier, and millions of Kelvin. We are now at temperatures of 10 to the 8 Kelvin, and now the physics change significantly. Gas with these temperatures have very long cooling time because it's physically much more difficult to radiate away these energies. So we are, when we look at stellar winds of these O stars, at the energy-driven feedback. And the wind momentum is comparable to the stellar radiation momentum. So it's about 1/2 of this. We can compute the corresponding mechanical luminosity of the wind from the mass flux and the wind velocities. And this is given here by this expression, and integrating over the lifetime of a massive star, this gives us the total mechanical power in the wind that is 10 to the 50 erg for typical numbers. So these are mechanical powers that are entirely comparable to the energies or the power that's released by a supernova. When we look at the equation of motion and assume that energy is conserved, so half goes into the heating, we can write this down and again with this ansatz look for a similarity solution. So what we find here is that T depends on a power law index of 5 eta minus 3, but assuming energy conservation, the left-hand side must be independent of T because we assume a constant luminosity. And this means eta needs to be 3/5. We can compute the A prefactor and then give the radius of this shocked shell that is in the order of 16 parsec times, of course, here all our typical quantities. And 16 is a few times larger than the radius of the H2 region that we computed earlier. So the wind will move much faster and drive the ionized gas into a thin layer between the hot wind gas and an outer cooler shell. So if the energy-driven limit is correct, this hot shell remains hot because it cannot get rid of the energy. Of course, this is a very weak assumption because in small perturbations in the density or so might make it easy for the gas to break out. However, if in case this is true, we have a thin shell of very hot shocked gas that should produce X-ray emission due to their high temperature. And we can compute the pressure of the X-ray emitting gas. The shell is expanding for a given time t, so the total energy in the shell is the luminosity times d time. The pressure is 2/3 of that energy density in case of a monoatomic gas, so we can write it down as a function of the stellar luminosity. And we can also write down the pressure that's exerted by the radiation. So that's twice that exerted by the wind in the momentum-driven limit. So we can also write it down as a function of the stellar luminosity. And when we take the trapping factor, so we have the wind pressing this shell outwards, and we have the pressure in the shell that also goes oppositely to the wind, so it counters the wind pressure. And the ratio between is the so-called trapping factor, which depends on the luminosity and, of course, of the expansion velocity of the shell. And we can write this down as the wind velocity divided by the expansion velocity of the shell. So if the shell expands in energy-driven limit because of the winds, then the pressure of the hot gas within should exceed the direct radiation pressure by about a factor Vw divided by V. In the momentum-driven limit, this factor, the ratio between the two pressures, is about half. There are a few regions that we can observe where we find very massive clusters interacting with the ISM and producing this X-ray. One is, for example, in 30 Doradus in the Large Magellanic Clouds. And there we find expansion velocities, 20 kilometers per second, and wind speeds of 1,000, so a trapping factor of 20. However, we observe a trapping factor of only 50. So, assuming that our assumed expansion velocities and wind velocities seem to be not true, and therefore we have to conclude that in these circumstances, the winds of the massive stars are probably more in the momentum-driven limit compared to the energy-driven limit. So this is an example of 30 Doradus. And we see here in blue these bubble-like structures. These are cavities of very hot gas, where we have the X-ray at the shells produced. So we have clusters inside. They produce winds that press the ambient material outside. And in these, and the surface of these winds, we have the very high temperatures producing the X-rays. So we can observe these effects. Another possible feedback effect are supernovae. We can model Q, M, and T here as a delta function. So that's the supernova that at some time goes off and injects all the energy and momentum of the supernova in a single burst at the time TLM, where TL is the lifetime of the progenitor star with mass M. And when we assume an energy yield per star of 10 to the 51 erg and the minimum mass of 8 solar masses, then we can compute the supernova energy per unit mass and have to integrate just from the minimum mass to infinity here, where this factor is the number of stars above 8 solar masses, which is the number of expected supernovae. So the energy per supernovae times the number of expected supernovae. Looking at a particular IMF, so the Chabré IMF, we find a number that is about 1% per solar mass. And when we compute the supernova yield per solar mass, we find 10 to the 49 erg per solar mass, or 6 times 10 to the minus 6 c squared. We have in the Milky Way a star formation rate that is in the order of 1 solar mass per year. So when we have about 0.01 supernovae per solar mass, this means we expect 1 supernova per century in the Milky Way. The momentum yield from supernovae, when we look at the ejection velocities that are in the order of 10 to the 9 centimeters per second, then the momentum can be given by the energy divided by the velocity. So we have something like 55 kilometers per second as a function of the ejection velocity. And we see that this is relatively small compared to some of the other effects that we presented already.